Good morning, everybody. So it's my pleasure to be here with you, and thanks also to the entire organizing committee for inviting me to this workshop, which I think promises to be very stimulating and hopefully also productive. And actually, as already indicated by Wolfram Horstmann, initially it's sort of nice to see how things evolve over time. Actually, I think it's indeed a timely way to progress now, and sometimes I feel like an old veteran when coming to these meetings, because when I was at the 2003 Berlin Declaration, it was all about open access only, and I was one of the few people pushing for things like open peer review also. I know that there have been many people already way before that pursuing that, but sort of things are going in cycles, but after all they are progressing. And so when, actually just as a brief background, I'll share with you some concepts and also lessons learned along the way of this enterprise. But one aspect I wanted to tell up front is what triggered me in the year 2000 to venture into open peer review is frustration with the traditional peer review. I'm still mostly a practitioner, researcher, and university teacher. And so that was evident that we need to improve on that side. And when I approached people in our scientific community back then in the European Geosciences Union, or the predecessor, and actually it was Anne Richter who started a little, very little back then, publisher Copernicus, which has grown quite a bit with these journals. When we talked about doing this open peer review, the term open access didn't even exist yet, right? So what he said, I just said, let's do something like that, and here's the design. And he said, well, if we do it on the internet, let's make it free. So that was how people thought about it back then. And then this whole open access motion came up right in the early 2000s. And I think now it's very important to go back also to the things that have been pushing people already. Actually, archive.org was largely inspired also in having something that prepares peer review and fosters it, and also subsequent developments. And so again, I just want to share with you some of the, again, concepts and lessons learned. And just very briefly, because most of you, I guess, know this stuff and will probably also agree on most of it, But again, this relation between open access and public discussion, I think they are all needed for many very good reasons. But what drives me most, of course, are the scholarly advantages, and that you really get the full benefit of immediate access and efficient and rapid quality control. So I think, again, many good reasons to merge public knowledge and scientific knowledge and so on, which apply to all forms of open access and recent developments. But I think indeed improving peer review is a key thing that we should devote to. And again, I think I don't need to tell that to you, that's why you are here, but that has been indeed a confusion for a long time, that open access would be detrimental to quality assurance, where indeed the opposite is true, that it's really needed to enable more efficient peer review for the future. And what I mean with this, I'm going to show you soon. I guess also, as Tony has pointed out in the beginning, there are lots of problems with peer review and well documented over time. But in essence, one key thing is there, even when classical peer review works very well, which is actually quite often the case. In many cases, classical peer review works quite well, but even then, information is getting lost, right? Because you don't document how the discussion has taken place. And so this is really a key thing with the traditional pre-publication peer review. So you go, you walk from one journal to the next if things get rejected and so on, but nobody can keep trace of what has been the pre-discussion of these manuscripts. And again, even if the manuscript then gets published eventually, you don't see how people have interacted on it. So I think it's really a waste of reviewing capacities, and actually reviewing capacities, it's really the referee's time, is the most limited resource in scientific publishing and exchange. Of course, editor's time is also something that is limited, but referees is even more important. So I think we have to do everything we can to keep things attractive and facilitate good interaction for the reviewers, for the referees, whatever you want to call it. And so there have been actually quite a few trials of open peer review in one way or the other in very long ago already. So I think the British Medical Journal was one of the first venturing into that into the 1990s. But I think most earlier attempts tried to fully replace the classical peer review by only post-publication review, sort of, right? And what we tried from the beginning, from the year 2000 and 2001 when we then started, and I'll show you the statistics later on, is really to keep the strength of the traditional peer review and to evolve it and to make it more transparent, but not throwing the good things overboard. And that's what I mean with really combining and truly integrating, and I'll show you where these crucial points of integration are, as opposed to just putting things back to back, how you couple things, combine these strengths of traditional review really with the virtues of transparency, discussion, which is the essence of science, and self-regulation also. And so again, one of the basic problems in scientific publishing is, of course, speed versus quality. Everybody wants to be fast. People are trying hard with various journals and platforms to be fast. And on the other hand, you want to have thorough review and discussion. And usually that takes some time. Occasionally it goes quick, but usually it takes some time. And so I think in principle, the only thing that I found so far to combine these two aspects is to have one after the other, but again integrated, so you can go ahead quickly, and we call it a discussion paper, a preprint, e-print, whatever you call it. You put it out there, and then you let it undergo review and interactive discussion. But then the question is how exactly you do it. I'll come back to that a bit later, whether you make it permanently archived immediately or you let people take it out again. That has a lot of to do with how people approach these things, right? And then whether you really make the review citable traceable, or whether you then still do the review separately, like archive.org. You always, physicists have been putting out preprints for very long, but then afterwards they went to a journal, and then the whole thing went on in a hidden way again, and so on. So that was decoupled. And actually I will come back to that, but I'll mention it now already because it's so important. There is a very nice, I tried to trigger this for a long time and proposed it to a lot of people, but independently of that, Jean-Sébastien Coe from the University of Amsterdam now made a big attempt of putting such interactive publishing onto archive.org. And I think we will see and hear a lot more from this initiative, which will be very nice. And well, then you finish it up and you come to a final paper. And so here is essentially the concept, and everybody who knows peer review, classical standard form in the natural sciences, at least there are many variants of classical peer review also, but the standard way is outlined up here. There is nothing missing, and essentially up here also nothing added. An author submits a manuscript, an editor does a pre-check, consults referees, then there are referee comments, author replies, there is this exchange, everything can be going in cycles upon demand, and then in the end the editor decides again in exchange with the author, possibly again with the referees, whether a final paper will be published. And the only thing we changed here initially was to make this box transparent and to open it up to contributions from the public community. So it's two steps, but nothing lost from the traditional way. And to integrate, and that's what I mean with integrative. So here we really, and that's the big difference to many other attempts that have been made, that we really integrate the classical review and the classical interaction between referees, editors, and authors with the comments from the public. And the reason why I consider this integration so important is actually that the referees have an incentive to contribute to the formation of a strong paper. Let me maybe go back here. If you do only post-commenting back here, which is possible also in traditional journals, but doesn't happen so often, it's simply you are sort of hitting the other one from behind, right? People have published their paper and now you are commenting on it. Of course, you can make nice little comments and add-ons, but somehow if you want to make a substantial critique, it's not going into the process of improving that one study, right? And if you do it early enough, you can do that. And that's what we see. People like it, and again, I'll show you the statistics, that they can enter here and really contribute to the final product in a very constructive way. And so the reason, one of the key reasons why our initiative has been flying very quickly after we started it in 2001, indeed within a few years it went to the top of the ranks of journals in the atmospheric and climate sciences, in passing a lot of traditional journals on the way, is simply that it is an all-win situation. If you look at it carefully, we offer something to everybody involved. In the first place, to the authors, they have free speech, rapid publication. We offer something to the reviewers. They get recognition for what they say. We let them stay anonymous if they wish. In our community, that's a key feature. It's optional. Many of them sign their comments, but most actually don't sign. Still, the majority does not sign. The comments, and again, we have 15 years of statistics now with a big journal. But even if they don't sign the comment, what they say is being heard and archived forever. And as a scientist, you want your stuff to be used, heard, seen, and used, right? That's the incentive for being a scientist. And so that's the same thing for these referee comments. And that you achieve by the transparency, whether it's anonymous or not, is secondary in that sense, right? And then so for the entire community, the key thing is saving reviewing capacities by low rejection rates. I get back to that. You can achieve very low rejection rates through self-selection because authors, the only ones who don't gain from this procedure are authors who want to push through very quickly some crappy publication. Because if you are caught in public with negative comments on this quickly pushing through something, it's not so nice. So they don't anyhow come to our journal, and that's why we have very low rejection rates, even though it's a very visible journal. And one thing here also, just to make it explicit, right? It's not only maximizing quality assurance by this integrative process here, it's also that the final revised paper essentially already contains the essence from these comments. If you do only post-commenting rather than integrated commenting, the information density here doesn't get as high, right? And as a scientist, those of you who are like me working in science and researching, usually you read the title, then you decide whether you look at the abstract, then you look at the abstract, then you decide whether you look at the whole paper, and you don't have time to read everything, the whole ballpark around it, but so you go step by step and then you start to read also the comments, reviewer comments or post comments, but you can't read everything up front. So information density is really key, especially nowadays in the internet, that we have much more information than anybody else except Google can process essentially. And hopefully it will not be a monopoly anymore in the future, but currently nobody reads everything. In the future, when it's all open access very soon, hopefully, actually, every garage company will be able to read and process everything. And so just what we have lots of examples, so I would recommend to you, if you are really interested, go to our online library. Obviously, everything is freely accessible. It's most commented papers. There is a tab in the library. Here it's already one example. There's the link up here, and I'll be happy to make the slides available afterwards also. And we had very recently actually one really controversial paper that was sort of in the wake of the Paris negotiations about climate and so on. So that attracted indeed a lot of comments, 110 comments on that one paper. And that was really also at the edge of the scope of our journal. And the nice thing was even there, there was self-regulation in the discussion. We were not flooded by comments from climate deniers, some climate change deniers, right? Some of these comments were popping up, but the community went against it and so on. And so it was highly self-regulating, even in this case, at the very edge of the topic. And even with much less visibility in the broad scale, but within the meteorological community, also there were a couple of papers about how things evolve, why we have thunderstorms or not out in the atmosphere, also heavily discussed with very fundamental aspects. And you're welcome to read these. And then we have a lot of comments when it's really fundamental controversy. Most papers actually only trigger a few comments. That's the statistics here, and you don't need more. For a standard article that just advances science substantially even, but just advances it some bit, you don't need a lot of comments. You have nice referee comments, critical ones, and response from the authors, and that's it. So one key thing, so the overall statistics are here, and I will be happy to get back to it later on if you're interested in details, but the key thing is we have very low rejection rates already prior to the discussion forum, and then even lower rejection rates prior to the final journal. Other journals in our field reject 70% of manuscripts, 50%, right? Even though they have a much lower impact and visibility, they have to reject a lot more. We have to reject fairly little because people think twice indeed whether they submit to an open discussion forum, right? But people with controversial stuff, again, that's the thing. If you do it in a careful way, those people got rejected in 2008. They only had a discussion paper. So after the discussion, it was stopped. It did not enter the final journal. Still, they came back with the same thing to defend it again, and then it was indeed accepted. So you can see science at work openly and transparently, and I really invite you to look at these manuscripts if you are interested in more details. And just one thing, also that sort of additional comments from the community on top of the classical referee comments, there is only one in five papers roughly, one in four, one in five, one in six, that get such additional comments. So that may sound little, but it isn't actually. We don't even want much more because scientists also don't want to go for nonsensical, useless comments all the time, right? You want to focus on really relevant comments, and mostly the relevant stuff is already said by the reviewers, so there is no need for other comments. But one in four, the volume actually is big. It's 50% of the total volume because the comments do say a lot. They are substantial, but the number is actually not so big. So five in total per paper, and only one in four papers attracts an additional comment, but from traditional papers, you get an additional comment only in 1 in 100 papers. So in relation, we have a lot more interaction, right? So again, I don't want to lose you by going too far into the details here, but we do know our statistics very well and we can discuss it. So all the claims I'm making, I can also support with proper data. And essentially, we are up to publishing 1,000 papers, and it's a mainstream journal. It's not a small niche, about 1,000 papers every year. And the interesting thing is sort of a unique combination, and that's this all-win situation, right? It's top speed. We just need about 1 week from submission to publication in a discussion forum, right? It's like archive.org, you just even need 1 day maybe, but we can also do it within 1 week, even though it goes through a more formal publishing process. So it's top speed. We do have top impact and visibility with all the problems of the journal impact factor. We do have top values there. Sometimes it's number one, it depends on how you count it, it's whether it's one number one, two, or three, doesn't matter. But it's top impact and visibility. It's large volume. It's one of the largest, by now I think, the largest journal in our field of atmospheric and geosciences, environmental sciences. So out of these ISI index classes, it's one of the big classes there. And it has low rejection rates. And this combination of top impact, normally low rejection rates, people associate with low quality, whatever. But no, if you make things transparent, low rejection rates can be achieved together with large volume and top speed. And again, to my knowledge, this is up to now fairly unique across the board. But I hope that this will actually, by this SciPost, it's called the Physics Journal of the Future, building on archive.org, I hope that they will sort of do that at even larger scale and go ahead in this direction. And so it's all fully financeable and so on. So this is anyhow a discussion of the past, and it works very well. We can get back to it later if you wish. So the conclusions are, yes, after these 15 years, we can combine the strength of traditional publishing and peer review with new ways of doing it. This public review and discussion can be flexibly adjusted, and I will go to this now quickly for some minutes to show you how what we did, what worked very well for our community, other communities will be different, but you can adjust the same concept to, I would claim, almost any scientific or even scholarly community, right? And it, you just need to adjust the checks and balances and how you do it, and I'll dwell on that a bit more. And then, yeah, yes, transparency does enhance self-regulation. Of course, it would be unimaginable how it would not do so, right? How do you get decent politics in a society? It's only by transparency, right? And it's the same thing in science policy and everywhere, of course, right? So transparency is a prerequisite for efficient progress and self-regulation also. And yes, it does work well. And also one key thing is, there was always the concern, well, scientific societies depend on their income from their traditional journals and it's also hard. No. This has been shown here in the year 2001 and following years that a classical scholarly society, which is EGU, EGS, was the old name, European Geosciences Union, can do these things. We converted also a traditional, well, several traditional journals. There were three traditional journals. They were converted from subscription to open access and from traditional peer review to this interactive peer review, and it worked very well for all the three traditional journals we had, and we started some 12, 13 new ones, and all of them worked well also. So it is all feasible, and much more can be done. Of course, there are a lot of other nice initiatives out there also. Quick thing on alternative concepts. Again, I think there is a lot of nice and exciting stuff out there, but it's important, I think, to be really successful and to cater for the needs of your community, you need to look at the details and subtleties. So whether you allow people to withdraw things, to delete things or not, whether you allow people to maintain anonymity, to choose whether they remain anonymous or go eponymous to sign their reviews and so on, that's really critical. And I think this integration sort of is out there. So this is just a quick brainstorming from my side, right? What to look at. So don't take that negative or exclusive or whatever. These are just some thoughts where how maybe some initiatives that have been out there were not quite as successful in their field, as far as I can tell, as we have been fortunate to be successful in our field. And partly it may be these little tuning effects, right, that make the full difference. And so we had in our board from the very beginning, all the way from a Nobel laureate to postdocs, we had all the people on board to have all the different views, and that's why we could design the right thing from the beginning and didn't have to adjust along the way very much. We just improved a few things. And I think that this multi-stage open peer review with this flexibility integrating everything really combines all the advantages that are not there necessarily in other concepts, although we'll see which ones flies best. So experimentation is definitely needed in all directions. So again, here is this SciPost archive. There is an article where all this is described at great detail. This is a flowchart, but actually coming here on the train. So one, I'll not dwell into these details that you can't read. But I think for the future, it will be important to combine and integrate also with Repositive. So this old dream and wish of combining this thing with archive.org is just coming true. SciPost has opened its door for submissions now in June. So have a look at this if you like. Then there are living reviews, concept ranking, and tiers. Of course, article level metrics are essential. And in the end, where we want to go is sort of an epistemic web, right? That doesn't only tell you what we know. Already now, the web is pretty good, and when open access has been established very soon, it will be very good at telling you all we do know, but then we should also know why and how we know it, right? And so that's the key thing for this, making also the review and the discussion transparent and going towards what could be called an epistemic web. And this chart, it's again incomplete. Again, this is sort of a side job, so I apologize if I left things out here. But what came to my mind, I made it on the train this morning, is essentially showing you how you can see this multi-stage process also. In the beginning, you have an author with a manuscript. Then the author can just shuffle it onto a preprint server with essentially no evaluation or very little technical evaluation, or you can go with a little more evaluation. That's how I haven't used it yet. For example, F1000 Research, which I consider also a very nice initiative, very similar to what we are doing actually. Or you can go for a discussion paper, which is already pretty formalized with a clear pre-screening, and we call it access review. So that's the first stage of review. Then you can go for public review and discussion. You can simply go from article version 1 to 2, or you go from specifically manuscript discussion paper to the journal article. That's what we have been doing for a long time, and also an economics journal. And SciPost will do the same thing, going from preprint all the way to the journal article with this public review. Then you have, and all this is already existing, then you can go from the regular journal article to highlight selections within a journal, or maybe that might be the future for Science and Nature to become assessment houses rather than publishing venues, but we'll see how that evolves. That was up in the discussion in 2003 already at the Berlin conference. But there is also this SciPost Select. We'll have across the board of physics some highlight magazine section and so on. And again, all that is at work already. And then, of course, that's also already at work, highly cited, ranked, used work, where you do the post-analysis, but that takes more time. So we have the quality assurance intensity or level on the y-axis here, and on the x-axis, effort and time. And so you have to wait, of course, for some time to tell afterwards how good the article was. And I just want to emphasize again how important open access is here to make this really work well and inclusive and comprehensive, and not depend on a monopoly or oligopoly of citation counters, right? So that's actually the one, from a researcher's perspective, one of the key things why we need open access quickly and fully to all the articles and to the final versions also, and in particular, is really to get away from this oligopoly of citation counting, but to do really context-weighted citation counting and even better metrics, right? Better usage metrics and so on. And I think that's essential for scientific evaluation at large. And so that's a big arrow. All of these are already going on, and I think now it's really time to optimize swiftly, not just to, I think we don't need to reinvent many wheels. A lot of wheels have been out there for several decades already, and we can put them together to have a nice train that goes on. So again, why do we do all that? I guess we all agree. We want to promote scientific and societal progress through these ways. We need access not only to information, but to high quality information. I think it's a value in itself to document the scientific discourse. And also, again, transparency and rationalism, if we want to have that in society and we are not able to deliver it in science, then we are on the wrong boat, I think. So we need to do that. And this is my last slide. I won't go through all the specific propositions, but I think, well, again, continue and promote experiments all along the way, open access peer review. I think one specific thing that could come out of this workshop possibly is really to go for and demand access to article reviews and pre-publication history. And a lot of journals have been doing that already. This you can also do without the interactive process. Just afterwards, if it's accepted, also show the reviews to show whether it has been reviewed at all and how it has been reviewed, right? So I think that's really key for the future development, also to go against this predatory open access publishing and so on. That's one of the key ways to go and to tackle this issue. I think it's an issue, not really a problem, but before it becomes a problem, we should tackle it and get rid of it. So yeah, new metrics are urgently needed. And I think also, again, in order to be efficient up there, we need open access soon and fully. And with that, I thank you for your attention.